So over the last few months, articles have been coming out everywhere about YouTube creators and content creators burning out. Now, one of the big reasons is they're not building real businesses with strong teams. So in this video, I sit down with leadership expert Peter Voogd, who hit 8 figures in top line revenue. Why? Because of building a strong team. And in this video, he's gonna be sharing his best tips coming up.
The YouTube Secrets audiobook is out now. Learn the latest strategies of today's top video influencers in this step-by-step YouTube success playbook. Download it now at tubesecretsaudio.com.
Hey, what's up? Sean Cannell here with Video Influencers, helping you build your influence, income, and impact with online video. And I'm so excited because today I'm sitting with Peter Voogd, author of 6 Months to Six Figures. He's back on the channel. How's it going?
Amazing, man. Excited to be here.
Super pumped to have you here. If you're new to Peter's work, he's really become known for going from 6 months to six figures, but and hitting over $8 million in revenue by age 27. Now, since then, he's gone far on to surpass that, but it's not something he did alone. He built a team. And as content creators, a lot of times we can not actually think outside of our own world. And maybe right now you think there's no way I could afford a team. Look, if you're just starting out, or even if you're more advanced in business, one way or another, great things do not happen alone. So in this video, we're gonna be breaking down the tips. But Peter, what's kind of the synopsis that you'd want people to know about who you are if they're just meeting you?
Well, I had no experience building a team. I didn't even think about six figures going up in a small town with 7,000 people. No one I've ever known made six figures or obviously seven figures. I dropped out of college, didn't have a lot of belief, didn't have a lot of confidence, but through trial and error, through obsession, and through wanting to have a lifestyle and wanting to control my business versus my business control me, I had to get good at building a team. So I became obsessed in 2009 and 10 on building a team. And I finally realized that was the one thing that not just took me from five to six figures, but from six to eight figures. And there's ways to do it wrong, like I did, and there's ways to do it strategically. And I wanna help people kind of cut their learning curve in half, Sean, so they don't have to go through all the mistakes I've gone through to actually build a team.
And we got five tips. And the first one actually is team building mistakes. What are some of them?
Well, not just mistakes in team building, but mistakes in hiring. Mm. I see articles too, like you talked about, but I know a lot of my friends and a lot of people in our industry that don't know how to hire or delegate, and that causes a lot of frustration. And eventually, God forbid, they go out of business or they settle and go to a 9-to-5 they hate. And I don't want that for anybody. It's now become more possible than ever to build a thriving business in this new economy. The number one mistake, hands down over everything else, and it caused me to go broke and stress out, was being Superman. What I mean by that is I had Superman syndrome. I started the business. I have to do everything myself. And that's a disease, because here's what happens, which is scary. If you think you have to do everything yourself, if you don't trust people, then not only do you get burnt out, Sean, but you start resenting and hating things that actually are your unique ability that you used to love. Mm. So it's like a double-edged sword, and it frustrates you, it allows results to go down, and eventually you go out of business. So that was the biggest mistake, is Superman syndrome. So first, you have to understand that the only way to really build a life and a business on your terms and to scale up is to develop people and build a team. So that's what I want to get across first, is there's no other way, right? You have to build a team. So another mistake too is not knowing what to delegate and how to figure that out. So I'll give them a system I've used for years that's really helped me. Hiring too slow or hiring too fast and firing slow. A lot of people like to hire fast, takes them forever to fire someone. Mm. It's the opposite. You need to hire super slow and strategic, make them jump through loops and really make sure you're purposeful. And if someone's not good for the culture, fire them quicker. That's another mistake I see. Hiring another entrepreneur sometimes, hiring someone too much like you, hiring based off promises and words, not results. Hiring just based off education and what they say and talk about. People will tell you everything you want to hear in an interview, but if you don't base it off real results, you'll usually be disappointed. So those are the most common ones I've seen.
Yeah.
So when you start making people jump through hoops, which we'll talk about, and you start really like crafting your ideal job description and really making sure that you find the right people and the A players, it's a game changer for your business. A lot of people are too impressed with formal education too, where you need to be impressed with people's previous results. You know what I mean? So that's a big one.
And another, maybe, would you agree with this kind of myth and mistake, is that sometimes people too, they think, well, I'm so far away from hiring because I don't got 40 grand to pay somebody for like a year. But you don't have to start that way.
No.
Like a lot of people, especially as content creators, you might just get an editor part-time. You might just get a virtual assistant to help you with admin. True, you can scale into building a team.
For sure, and you can also give people a part of your company, or you can share them on the vision. There's a lot of times where I didn't have the money to pay people at the beginning, but I had such a strong vision and such a strong focus of the future. Like, here's where we're going. I know I don't have money to pay you now, but if you want to work for free, I'd love to have you. If not, no problem. But that has worked in the past. Mm. So making sure that you share a vision, and some people say, I don't have the money to do it. Well, you have no other option. Mm. Like, so maybe if you're not beyond belief busy, then start understanding how to get results, sacrifice, and start making money, and then invest it back. So if you don't have any money, you need to learn yourself how to make money and develop a skill that allows you to add value to the marketplace, vice versa being paid. So if you have $0, maybe it's not your time to hire. Maybe you got to be more effective and efficient with your time and then start investing in your team. So it's just, it's reality checking yourself and figuring out where you are. Because the only way I feel like to improve your reality is to deal in reality. So the only, when I started hiring, Sean, I actually was making money and I finally had some things I could delegate that weren't my strength. So here's something, a list I went through. Write down a list of things you don't like doing, can't do, or shouldn't be doing. That's the things you should delegate. And my rule, which we'll talk about in a second, but if someone can do something 80% as good as you and it's not your strength and skill, delegate.
Delegate.
Yeah, so to answer your question, it definitely doesn't cost 40K.
Yeah.
And you can give people a piece of your company. You can pay them based off results. That's a big one. If you want someone to be part of your sales team, say, hey, I don't have the funds right now to pay you, but every sale you get, I'll give you 50% because you're someone new and you were starting on the ground floor. So sharing people on the movement. Plans are failing left and right these days. Movements are thriving. So if you can kind of create a movement around your business, people want to be a part of that. People are striving right now and so thirsty to be a part of something bigger than themselves. So that's kind of where it starts, is that burning desire to have a business that means something. Then people want to be a part of it.
Tip number two is creating a culture of excellence. What do you mean by that?
So culture eats strategy for lunch. Mm. And if you have the right culture, you don't have to persuade anyone to do anything. So when you finally start hiring and you create a culture of excellence, people want to be a part of it. You don't have to persuade anybody. More people want to join and it becomes a movement. And these big companies like Zappos and Amazon, that's what's happening. Google, they're creating a movement of innovators and entrepreneurs. So a couple tips. Culture is a reflection of three things at all times. What you preach, what your team sees, and what you recognize consistently. So what you preach daily, what your team sees, and what you recognize consistently. Whatever you appreciate, appreciates. So whatever you share that you want to see repeated will continue happening. And whatever you focus on multiplies. If you focus on results and positive attitudes, people showing up early, it magnifies. If you focus on the negative, it magnifies. So culture, we can dive in, because I think culture was one of the biggest keys to our success, is once I started defining my culture, everyone started coming and the results got way bigger. So here's the scary thing. You cannot create a culture that doesn't exist already inside of you, meaning what do you care about? Mm. So if what you care about is promoted and it means the world to you and it's actually authentic, you'll attract those kind of people. So let me give you some examples. So what do you care about? What are your convictions? What does your company and culture represent? What do you value most? What does your team value most? And what's the vision and purpose of your company? See, when you're challenged, you're always gonna go to your true beliefs. So I built a business with a couple hundred salespeople when I was 21, 22, up to 1,000, 7,000 salespeople when I was 25, 26, because of who I was and what meant the most to me. So you can't drive home a culture if you don't fully believe it. So that's what you have to figure out, is what are your beliefs that right now are either serving you or hurting you? So my old convictions, here's what I'll tell you. When I first got into business, Sean, my old convictions were, I'm not a good trainer, I'm too young, people won't be able to work for me because I'm only 22. Mm. I don't have enough experience. When I'm stressed out, I should take time off. I don't have a good territory. I'm in Tacoma, Washington. It's rougher. It's ghetto. There's no good people. A players won't work for me. I had all these limitations. And the result was I went broke and I was in the top or the bottom 5% of my company. So when you don't have a culture that's congruent to you and you have these limiting beliefs, you'll never attract the A players. And one of the biggest mistakes I also see is there's people that are mad they can't attract A players, but they're not an A player themselves. They're not executing like an A player, and they expect to attract people that are even better than them. It's hard to do. So you gotta make sure that you're on your game. So here's my new conviction. So fast forward a year, I can get anyone to succeed, and age is irrelevant. When I focus on something, it magnifies and multiplies. Recruiting is the answer, and marketing is the number one focus. Let's focus on that, and it multiplied. I'm always 100% in control of my recruiting, and stress is just a lack of results. And why I'm sharing some of these things is what your beliefs are determines your reality and your future of business. So my belief was, when I'm stressed, I should take a lot of time off. So when someone else is stressed on my team, my belief is just take time off. But my mentors and a lot of people I talk to are like, no, stress is usually a lack of results. You need to work more intelligently and more strategically and get the results and you won't be stressed. My philosophy changed, so did my results. So when I shifted my convictions of what my culture was, we were the top 1% of the company. Mm. And I was going from 80 hours a week broke to 30 hours a week making $300K or $400K. So your convictions have to be congruent to your culture. So here's my question. What convictions or beliefs are currently holding you back that's not allowing you to build a team that thrives? Does that make sense?
Yeah, super, super strong.
So what drives your culture? So when I was building my culture of millennials and anyone that you wanna hire, you have to figure out a couple things that drive your culture. For me, wealth and financial freedom. Valuable experience is what they wanted. Lifestyle and flexibility. Memories and relationships. So I would always promote those four things. If you're a part of this team, we want to help you create financial freedom at a young age. We had 19 and 20 year olds making six figures left and right. Mm-hmm. They had none of their family had ever made six figures. And there's this 18 year old kid with no experience and I'm making them six figures.
Yeah.
So they're like, what the heck? So once you have third person stories and you have proof, more people start coming. So my conviction was, this is what's gonna drive our culture. Wealth and financial freedom, lifestyle and flexibility. You want a lifestyle that you're proud of. You can work when you want. You have to be more disciplined, but if you can put in the hours here, you're gonna build a great lifestyle. So this is things that I believed. When I shared that, the right people were coming to my culture. So that's what you gotta do is figure out what means the most to you and what really resonates with you and start promoting that to your team. That makes sense.
This is Power Pack content. Hey, influencers, hit the like button. And this might be one you wanna rewatch and even take some notes on because this is some deep content that can help you really level up and take your game to a whole nother dimension. So that brings us to number three, which is the five questions to ask before hiring. What are those?
So it's important to ask yourself first, like, are you absolutely beyond belief as busy as possible and unable to do what needs to happen on a daily basis? So people need to realize some people wanna hire, but they're not even working at their max capacity. They're not even being as productive as possible. Mm. Then you're wasting money, right? So you wanna make sure you're focusing on your strengths and maximizing where you're at. And without a shadow of a doubt, you can't even get to the daily tasks because you're so focused and busy on your strength. So you have to realize that. And then figuring out what your time is worth per hour. Here's the five questions. How much money can I make with this specific task or this job? How valuable is my time to me? Okay, that's a big one. How valuable is money to me? How overwhelmed does this task make me feel? And is this a strength of mine? So when I'm thinking about what to delegate, I'm asking myself these questions. What is my time worth? If you don't know what your time is worth, it's really hard to measure activities against your time. And if you don't know what your time is worth, other people will determine it for you. So figuring out what your time is worth per hour, whether it's $25, $50, $1,000, $5,000, and start making lists and delegating things that are not worth your time, because you could be doing, if you could be doing something worth $500 an hour, why would you do something that you could delegate for $50 an hour?
Yep.
Right? So start thinking about what things you can delegate that are lower than the value that your time is worth. And those five questions have helped me do a lot of hiring, training, whether it's one-off, whether it's hiring like overseas, maybe it's a VA, or hiring someone full-time. It just kind of depends on where I'm at in my business and what my strengths are. So the delegation rule helps figuring out like, okay, out of these things, if someone can do something, just 80%, but it's not worth my time, I have to get rid of that. And I'll give you the tools on how to keep the expectations proper and how to train them. But that's the key, Sean, is just figuring out what your time is worth. How overwhelmed do you feel? Yeah. What's most important to you? If peace of mind's most important to you and something comes across your desk, the question should be, is this going to contribute to my peace of mind or contaminate it? If it's going to contaminate it, delegate it. If you love it and it's your strength, don't.
And one of the things you teach is identify your IPAs, your income producing activities. Yep. And you mentioned that in the questions. You know, influencers, we maybe know that when we upload a YouTube video, it can produce X with YouTube ads, with affiliate marketing. It leads to your business, a product you design. And you know the power. That's one of the things I identified early on was because of doing on Think Media, affiliate marketing and YouTube videos. I knew that I made some money from AdSense, some money from affiliates. And when I first stepped into actually working with an intern and then like a paid intern, I knew that there was some profit there. So I was building that momentum. So go through those five questions. That brings us to tip number four, which you say here is creating your ideal dream team. So what do you mean?
So once you develop yourself, you become an A player. And you figure out your culture and you figure out what you're incredibly good at doing in your business and what you hate doing and what your lowest impacts are, that's when you can start being strategic on reaching out. So it doesn't matter where you find them, but there's a lot of spots people don't think about, like social media, making an ad on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and saying, I need somebody, and then making them jump through loops. So when we were hiring receptionists, we were hiring executive assistants, I would say if we did an ad, respond with a paragraph sharing why you feel like we should accept you and what makes you different than all the other candidates. I'm not joking, Sean. 60% didn't even respond to the paragraph.
Because they didn't even read. They probably just sent a blanket resume or something.
100%. So then we get rid of them.
So it's you like, filter down to the real game changers.
Continue filtering. Then I had my assistant talk to them and ask specific questions. And then eventually the top 5 out of 100, I sat in front of or talked to. So have a filter system that makes them prove themselves through results and action. The biggest key is don't base it off words. Do not base it off words, sure. Base it off results. And in this day and age, if your company is proven enough, you can have people prove themselves. Say, hey, show me what you can do. If the results are there, I don't mind paying you. We have three or four people on our team right now that prove themselves, reached out to me and said, I wanna do your blank. I wanna do this. I will show you for a couple weeks or for a month. I'll do it for free and I'll give you value. If I can get results, and I'm like, if you get results, I'll pay you.
Yeah.
Some are making 5, 6, 7 grand a month strictly from working for free to give value first. So a lot of people look for that. Another key with me is I would reach out to all the local colleges. I would call, whether it's a specific niche that you're looking for, call the entrepreneur section, call different the career center and say, I have an internship. It's paid or non-paid. Any students that match this mold, please send them my way. I've shared this with my team, and I have so many people that I've influenced have hired A players that have been with them for years, literally from calling a college. Mm. So calling your local college, doing on social media, figuring out exactly what you need, I think is a big step to building your dream team. And of course, you need to have your culture. What does your company represent? What do you value most? What does your team value? What's the vision of your company? So when you figure that out, Sean, then it's deciding exactly who you need. What people do you need in your business? What would their role be? Who's involved now that might be a conflict with your culture that you might need to get rid of? And then create a process, create deadlines and dates. So defining your culture, defining who you need, putting out ads that attract the right people, and then filtering, creating a date like, okay, this is when the ad's going out, this is when we're gonna hire them by, this is when we're gonna train them. I always was systemized in my training where I would always put down when we're gonna put the ads out, giving 2 weeks to cast a net, lowering the net, making them prove themselves, okay, this week we're gonna go through the applications. This next week, I'm gonna sit with them. Week after, we're gonna train them. They're gonna be ready to go by blank. Then I always hired 2 people, put them on trial periods. Mm. Always. Never, ever hire officially hire someone unless they're on a trial period, because they're going to tell you everything you want to hear until it comes time to get real results. So when you put them on a trial period, the right person will show you what they're worth. And just, I mean, that's really it for me. Go with your gut and make sure that you feel good about the hire, and don't make it official till you really have put them through some challenges. Give them proper expectations, which I'll talk about next, but that's it. You just got to have the right feeling for it and make them jump through loops.
I love it. Influencers, this is next level value to really help us scale our businesses as content creators. So if you're getting value, smash the like button on this video and tell us in the comments section below, have you thought about building a team yet? What stage are you in your business? We talk about 3 stages: solopreneur, season, or really the side hustle season when you are not full-time yet, solopreneur season, or the scale season where you're building a team and moving past being a solopreneur. Let us know which season you're in, what your thoughts are about building a team in the comments. And this is also part of a bigger series. So we actually have covered a couple different topics. And so if you wanna watch other videos in this series with Peter on becoming a business-minded content creator, look, we gotta get past views and likes and vanity metrics. We need to really build serious businesses that have longevity and that can make a real difference as well as make a living for us and our families. And so check out that series. We'll link it up on the YouTube card and we'll post a link to it in the comment section below. But there's one final tip here, and this is the three keys to consistent performance for building a world-class team.
One of the best things I ever learned.
Okay, what does this mean?
So it's three things, that's it. So if you want to build a dream team, you have to provide ongoing training, period. If you train them once and they're done, you're screwed. So you have to provide ongoing training for three things. So the three things I always do with everyone that ever comes across our culture and my team, expectations, very clear. Exactly what to expect. When they were coming into my sales organization, I did the opposite of every other CEO, manager, leader, trainer, division manager, whatever. They would say, oh, you're gonna love it here. It's gonna be easy. You're gonna crush it. You're gonna make money. The second you tell them something and the expectations are different, almost always they resent you or they quit. So sales is not easy. So I would say, hey, it's not gonna be easy. You're gonna feel like quitting 20 times your first month, period. But it's because when you push past that, that's the reward. You're gonna feel like quitting because it's different and it's more valuable. You're not gonna feel like quitting Jamba Juice sometimes because it's easy. That's why you make $8 an hour. Nothing wrong with that job, but I know you're here because you wanna reach greatness. So I'm letting you know, because Nico and Jessica and Sydney, yes, they're making six figures at 19 your age, but they wanted to quit 100 times. So if you can push past that in the first month, then you're gonna love our team. I'm here, the second you go through a challenge, call me, I'll be there for you. But realize it's not gonna be all rainbows and fun. It's gonna be tough. You're gonna get rejected, this is gonna happen. You're gonna have no sales, people aren't gonna show up, but you gotta have the mental toughness to push past and we'll be there to help you. The rewards are amazing, but you have to push past that. Now, what happens when they wanna quit? Or they go through a challenge. Peter said this would happen.
They're not surprised by it.
Same thing with direct sales, same thing with entrepreneurship, same thing with videos and building a team of media entrepreneurs. It's like, hey, you're gonna be frustrated. I'm sometimes tough to deal with because I expect the best out of you and I'm gonna hold you to high standards, but I promise that there's a lot of rewards on the end of it of having your own like business or having a great lifestyle, making financial freedom, whatever. So expectations is key. So pinpoint the positive expectations and the worst case and the negative expectations. Because everyone else, I've never been in network marketing, but a lot of network marketers I know that I've helped, they say the number one thing that is the problem is they always say like, oh, you're gonna crush it. And they never ever give negative expectations. They're always like, you're gonna crush it. That's why there's so much attrition, 99% quit. If you can just be honest, then it's different, right? Yeah. Same thing with business. So that's number one. Number two is accountability. You have to have accountability systems in place until they prove themselves to be an A player based on results. Not words, results. So I always had accountability. They were doing sales. So I was like, how many calls did you make this week? How many appointments? How many did you schedule? How many did you sell? What was your referrals? So no matter what story they told me, the numbers didn't lie. So we had a sheet, accountability sheet, and there was little boxes. And I said, guys, the story's not gonna fit in the box.
Like, it's just the number fits in the box.
It's just the number. It's like the number tells me everything about your dedication, your success, your mindset. And we tracked everyone's results. So everything was flexible too, because we had people that were not 1099, or not W-2s, they were 1099. So someone would be like, why is Nico missing the team meeting? Why is he not here? He sold $16,000 last week and made $7,000 and he's 18. You did two appointments. He did 26. He could do whatever the heck he wants.
Sure. Because he's delivering the results.
100%. So yeah, but that was my mindset.
He's hitting his quotas. He's hitting his targets.
Exactly. So you can do whatever you want if you get results. And that was my mindset. Some companies don't work that way, which is why they can't attract the A players. But accountability. And then the last thing is feedback. So every single week we had key staff meetings, we had leadership meetings, we had campus relations meetings with some of the people that we were dealing with in campus relations, we had receptionist meetings. And I would always go through their accountability sheets and gave them feedback on how to get even better. That's when I taught them how to be more resourceful, how to be self-sufficient, how to reach out. I taught them kind of how to be, I don't want to say mini-me's, but I taught them how not to depend on me. Any problem they had, I said, hey, go research this. Here's a great audiobook. Here's this. And they became so self-sufficient that they knew the expectations, the accountability was there. They got so focused on what proven results were and what we wanted and what we tracked that the whole team crushed it. And then feedback was how to get better from their results that we've tracked. And the last thing is teaching people how to become more valuable. So we would have, and this is something that I never really shared, but I remember doing it. People would always wonder, why is he getting paid 120? Why is he getting paid 30? Why is he getting paid 60? Why is she making this much? It's like whatever value you bring is what you're paid. So if you want to make more money, just figure out ways to become more valuable. Go ask Sean what metrics we're tracking that are the most valuable and go get better at that. Mm. If you become irreplaceable, we have to pay you more.
Yeah.
So do more than you're paid for. That's how you make more money. So there's always people on my team that are like, I'm only making this. It's like, here's how you know if you're valuable. If you're gone all next week, how does our team do? How do our results do? If nothing changes, I love you, man, but you're not that valuable. Yeah. Like, you're amazing. People love you, but you got to work on your results.
Yeah.
And I said, hey, if Sydney left, you guys know if she was gone next week, we would be screwed. That's why she's making blank. So teaching people entrepreneur ways of how to become more valuable is a big game changer. So expectations, accountability, feedback, ongoing training, that's how you build a dynasty.
Man, so fire. This video influencers is really gonna be a game changer for you. Again, even if you're just hearing this and it's majorly stretching you, you're like, look, I'm just trying to make it in my side hustle. You gotta think this way. And Peter's content has really transformed our business, really helped us scale. We were at six and multiple six, helped us scale to seven figures in our business overall. And so highly recommended. The next step actually is, I would say go deeper. We did another video series on Peter's book, 6 months to six figures. And so if you wanna watch that, we'll link it up on the YouTube card and post the link in the description below. All of this is about inside of our business-minded content creator series that is committed to helping you go further, faster, build a real business. So remember, question of the day, tell us in the comments, which season are you in? Are you still in that side hustle season? Are you a solopreneur? And this is like the perfect video for you because you're like, man, I'm a solopreneur working like 40, 50, 60, 70 hours a week.
That was me.
I've been there too, and you knew you had to get out of it. If you're in that season, or maybe you're in the scale season and these strategies will just help you build a stronger team, tell us in the comments section below. Peter, if people want to connect with you on social media, where can they find you?
At Peter J. Voogd, pretty much everywhere. Yeah, I'm excited to connect with them. If they have any questions, anything they need clarified, they can reach out and I'll reach out back to them and help them out. And you said something. You said, I know you might be expanding your capacity. That's a good thing. If you're a little bit like your head hurts, that means you're growing. I think expanding capacity and being overwhelmed a little bit is a good thing because it means you're kind of shifting your perspective. So I'm excited.
I love it. So hey, influencers, check out the full series. We'll link it up in the description below and we'll see you in the next video. Peace.
See you guys.